I have lots of things. You can hear me, right? So I'm going to discuss. What I would like to discuss is measurement values as produced by computation. Okay, I guess I have to remain like this. That's for man, not for women. Okay, measurement values as produced by computation. Since measurement values were produced not only by measurement precisely, but also by computation. And in this context, I'm going to focus on fractions whose relationship with measurement units we are going to examine. But I have a more general issue in mind, a general issue in the background of this talk, and this derives from this statement that we read on the invitation we received to come and attend this meeting, where we read, "We wish to understand how mathematical notations and measurement units evolved in their practical context through processes of standardization and measurement practices." So first of all, for me, practical context today will be a context of mathematical practice within a given mathematical culture. So what I mean by mathematical culture is probably what Babou referred to as subculture, and we could discuss about this, but this is not the topic. So first of all, keep in mind that for me, the context of practice will be a context in which actors are doing mathematics. Second, what I would like to discuss is the issue of the standardization of mathematical notation. And what I would like to put forward is the thesis that looking for standard notations or for standardization of notations with respect to fractions might be a historiographic trap, by which I mean that I would like to show that there has been, in a given specific context in China, there has been a standardization for the notation of fractions, but it depended on the operation. And what was noted was first operations, and then fractions in the context of these operations, and hence the notation depended on which operation was carried out. So what will be at stake in my presentation will be the standardization of the execution of operations. So speaking of standardization for operations or notation in the context in which I'm going to address this issue is a complex endeavor. And the reason for this is this. This is the typical appearance of Chinese mathematical texts before the 10th century. Namely, we have characters and characters and characters, and these discursive parts are referring to material objects. I'm sorry? I didn't close that window. I will have problems closing it because it's not on my screen. Okay, let me go. It's not on my screen, it's only just 1 second. Thank you, Sho. Oh my God. Shall I quit? Yes, yes. No, but the problem is, it might be gone, but I will close. Several things are gone. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay. So, looking for standardization of operation is a tricky operation for the following reason. So, before the 10th century, Chinese mathematical texts looked like this. Characters and characters and characters and characters. The text refer to material objects. Among these material objects, you have blocks for the computation of volumes, you have diagrams, it's not my topic today, and you have counting rods with which actors computed. And these counting rods were used on surfaces, but the text do not represent them. That's until the 10th century. After the 10th century, we see all kinds of elements entering into the composition of the text, diagrams, like in this example, or representation of computations, like in that example. So there is a continuity, between practices with diagram before the 10th century and after the 10th century. There is continuity between the use of counting rods before the 10th century, but all of this has to be elaborated on the basis of clues in text. So if I want to speak of standardization of notation and standardization of the execution of operation, it's weaving clues, because before basically the 10th century, we have no representation of calculations, no representation of executions or how numbers were represented. So keep please this in mind that we will have to weave clues. Another point is extremely important, and that is the vector of standardization. The vector of standardization is a set of 10 canons that were composed before the first century, before the Common Era, and the 7th century, and all these canons were brought together. Ancient commentaries on some of these canons brought together with the canons, and this became the text taught in the University of Mathematics at the Imperial University, starting from 656, when a new edition was of these 10 canons was prepared under Li Chunfang's supervision. So you can see on this slide that I've represented this list of 10 canons in two sets. They correspond to two curricula at the university. We will be interested in the most elementary curriculum. And I've put them not in chronological order, but in the order in which Alexei Volkov has suggested, on the basis of evidence, that they were taught. And his order is interesting because The first canon taught begins with describing a number system with rods. So we do not see it, but it's described. Begins with introducing measurement units and begins with a description of an algorithm for multiplication and division. Among the canons here, I will be referring to this first mathematical canon by Masterson soon. I will refer very briefly to the 9 chapters on mathematical procedures. I'm not going to dwell on dates and so on, because just think you are a 7th century person and these are the books you are dealing with. It's not, I mean, I will mention this from time to time for some reason, but I'm not going to dwell on this. I had the handout. I don't know whether it was copied or not. And in fact, I gave you a translation from this canon on the handout, to which I will come. And I will also evoke the earliest canon that was taught in the 7th position, and that was probably composed between 100 before the Common Era and the 1st century of the Common Era. So why was this set of books a vector of standardization? Because these books were regularly taken up to be a basis for a teaching of mathematics in imperial institutions. That doesn't mean that mathematics was always taught with these books, but at least we have some traditions that took these books as reference. Now, let us begin by the beginning of the elementary curriculum. The mathematical canon by Masterson describes writing numbers with rods in what appears to have been a place value number system. When you write 1, 2, 3, it means 123. I wouldn't like to dwell on how you represent 1, 2, and 3. It's not important. And then we have an algorithm for multiplication and division, which we all restore as follows. And I would like to describe very briefly a little bit the algorithm for division, because it will be very important for us. So we put the dividend in the middle row, leaving the upper row empty. So the upper row is empty, the middle row has a dividend, and the divisor is in the lower row. We push leftwards the divisor by as many places as we can. Clearly, we could not push 23 under 13, because we cannot divide 13 by 23. So we put 23 under 131, which amounts to having multiplied 23 by 10. Remember, shifting the divisor amounts to multiplying by powers of 10. Then we put the first digit of the quotient on top of the last digit of the divisor, 5, and we do, instead of doing 50 times 23 minus this, we do 5 times 230 minus that we subtract from 1,311, we get 161. Again, to get the digit of the units of the quotient, we push rightwards 23. We look for the piece, the digit of the units, and we multiply by 23, and we subtract from this. The reason why I put multiplication in front of division is because, first of all, I took the multiplication opposed with the division, 57 multiplied by 23. You see that it will play on multiplying 23 by powers of 10, again by shifting it, and it will multiply 23 in its position by the successive digits, adding this time to the middle row. Without entering into the detail, what is really important is, believe me, I'm not going to show it in detail, that position by position, these two operations have a relationship of opposition. And this corresponds to a statement we have in the text, the two operations are opposed with one another. So in the upper row, we begin full, and here we begin empty. We will empty the upper row through multiplication. We will fill up the upper row through division. We will fill up the middle row in multiplication and empty the middle row in division, whereas the 23 will do exactly the same thing. It will move left and right to be multiplied by powers of 10. These are the elements that I'm going to use. What I would like to emphasize is that you see that we have somehow two systems of positions that are articulated with one another. We have top, middle, lower position, okay, and we have left, middle, right. So in fact, we have a table here on the basis of which we conduct the operation. And we also have positions that are used to analyze the flow of the computation. And these positions that are used to analyze the flow of composition, they allow us to compare the operation and to find in the execution relationship between the operation. So this is a practice, a mathematical practice that will be extremely important later on, as I will point out. This is not the key point of my talk, but what is really important, here we are at the beginning of the curriculum, we are in 400, we have very good reason to believe that this multiplication and division were used like this in the first century. I'm not going to dwell on these reasons, but what is important is that this is a 13th century text, and now we have computations represented. And you see that you have quotient, dividend, and divisor. So you have exactly the same layout for the computation. Here we are in the operation of division where we have computed a first digit of the quotient. We are going to compute the second digit of the quotient. What the text says is you move the divisor one left rightwards by one position. So you see that this divisor is moved. It begins here, and now it's going to be placed under the next digit. And you have the next digit of the quotient, which will be multiplied by this to be subtracted from this. So you see that you have exactly the same layout, exactly the same execution. How can one imagine that one has, for so many centuries, this kind of standardization in the operation? The vector, in my view, is this set of texts that has conveyed the execution of the operation. Now, as I said, in the mathematical canon of Masterson, we have this statement that the algorithm for division is exactly opposed to that of multiplication. And this was what I showed you by showing that row by row, we have a relationship of opposition or similarity. There is a play with the rows without entering into details. I want to show you in the same corpus a square root extraction and a cube root extraction. You will see, I don't want to enter into any detail, you will see that the text refers to division, so there is a relationship between two operations and division. And you also see that the texts are written in parallel to one another, jumping one column, jumping two columns, multiplying twice, multiplying once, which is not necessary, but there is an emphasis on the relationship between the operation. And if we restore, for instance, the square root extraction based on this text, we discover again that we have upper row, middle row, lower row, quotient, dividend, divisor, despite the fact that we are dealing with a square root extraction, and rows being correlated with what we have in a division. So what I want to emphasize with this is that a certain type of execution of division depends on a mathematical practice of looking for relationship between operations. And this practice of looking for relationship between operations relies on a practice of computation on a surface with counting rods. So you have a practice with a mathematical meaning looking for the relationship between operations, and somehow this is, because it has a meaning, because it is a mathematical practice, that in my view, you have this standardization of the execution. I'm not yet with fractions, but we are arriving with fractions. Because in fact, this algorithm and this practice, we have the first traces in the first century of the Common Era. And before that, we have another algorithm for division. Division being, by definition, the operation that is going to generate fractions. So to understand this earlier execution of division, we need to look into a different corpus of text, namely manuscripts from the 3rd century and the 2nd century before the Common Era, manuscripts that were either excavated from tombs or bought on the antiquities market. The first manuscript that was found, writings on mathematical procedures, the tomb was sealed in 186 before the Common Era. The second manuscript that was found is believed to have been written before 212, before the Common Era. And there is an etc. here because more manuscripts have been found, and these manuscripts have not yet been published, so we cannot rely on them. Now, the key point of the other execution of division that I'm going to show you now, the key point is that the quotient will not be produced digit by digit, but the quotient is going to be produced measurement units by measurement units. Okay, let me explain to you. We have a problem. This comes from one of the manuscripts. We don't need to get into the detail. We have the problem of dividing 5 ch. This is a measurement unit for length, which is equal, excuse me, to 10 tun, the next measurement unit. These are the only 2 measurement units that we will need to remember. And 5 ch is divided into several parts that should have a relationship between them as the weights 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. So basically, what we need to do is to multiply 5 ch by each of these things separately and divide by the sum. So we will simply look at 5 ch multiplies by 32. Doesn't matter the details. This is 160. So we have 160 ch that we want to divide by the sum of all these weights, namely 62. So here is the division that we have to make. 160 ch divided by 62. So this is, okay, so I'm going to read a bit of this text, but you have to see that I'm not going to comment on all the dividends. I'm going to comment only on one dividend. You have all the divisions that are prescribed in parallel with one another. So, first of all, you have to see that the dividend is a measurement value using the same terminology as introduced by Christine this morning. And what is really important is that the result of this division will be produced as a certain number of ch and a certain number of tun and a fraction. So you see that it's not digit by digit, but measurement unit by measurement unit. So it's another execution of division. Now, how do we get the number of ch? You remember we have 160 ch, we divide by 62. We subtract repeatedly, and every time we have something which is like 62 in 160, we add 1 unit to the quotient. I subtract once, 1 ch, I subtract twice, 2 ch, and so on. Then we arrive at a point when we cannot subtract any longer. What the algorithm does is, what remains is, believe me, what remains is 38 ch, from which I cannot subtract 62. What the algorithm does is to multiply by 10 and hence transform the 38 ch that remain into tun. Then we have tun that we divide by the divisor, and we do it in the same way. We divide, we subtract repeatedly, and every time we subtract once, we add 1 to the. Okay. So this might look like a specific operation. What I would like to show you is that, in fact, this is a standardized way to which the manuscript attests to compute a division. We have another example in the other manuscript. This time, this is about capacity measurement unit, and we will see again do and shang, one do being equal to 10 shang. And you see you have exactly the same type of there was something I did not read. So I want to show you that there is a standardization in the execution of the operation. But what I would like to show you is that we have a correlation between this execution of division and the introduction of a concept of fraction that we find since that time in Chinese mathematical text, which is what we take to be n m's of a given measurement unit presents itself out of, I take a unit, I cut it into m parts, and of these parts that I create by cutting the unit into m parts, I take n. So we have a concept of fraction with units being divided into a number of parts that corresponds to the denominator, and the numerator is the number of parts you take out of these parts. And now I would like to show you first that the execution of division is standardized at the time, and second, that the introduction of fractions fits with this algorithm for division. So this is another division from the other manuscript. Now what we have are capacity measurement units. So again, we have a divisor, a dividend. What in the dividend is like the divisor yields one do, repeated subtraction to get as many of the highest units as we can. When this is completed, we multiply by 10, transforming the remainders into Shang, and we begin again subtracting the divisor to get a number of Shang. And we have another example of this division now with measurement units for weight. So you see that there is this production of the quotient measurement unit by measurement unit, not digit by digit. It's really extremely important. So here we have some variations that are going to be interesting for us to shed light on how the operation is understood. What is important is that now weight measurement units are not decimal. And we will have a quotient that will be produced as a certain number of Liang and a certain number of Zhu, and the relationship between Liang and Zhu is 24. Okay? So we begin again, this is what I've called phase type 1, subtracting the divisor and adding 1 to the quotient 1 Liang every time we have subtracted once. Okay? Then, what does not fill up the Liang? This is a very interesting expression, but I have to go. What? So, if you have a remainder in the dividend, which is not, from which you cannot subtract the divisor, what you do is each unit in the remainder, you take it as 24, you cut each unit into 24 to transform the Liang in the dividend into Zhu. And how do you cut this? By multiplication. So here you have 1 being taken as 24, and here you have the numerical operation that corresponds to it, namely multiplying by 24. Then you go on with a repeated subtraction to get the number of Zhu of your quotient. And what do you do next? You have a remainder, okay? You have completed the set of units you want to do. What you're going to do is you have a remainder and you name its part with the divisor. What does that mean? You have a remainder. You're going to cut each unit, each Zhu, into as many parts as the divisor. So you will have the remainder times the divisor. And each unit, when you have done this multiplication, each unit, each Jew, is cut into as many parts as the divisor. So when you divide by the divisor, the result is exact. The result is the remainder, but you have changed the unit. The unit is no longer the Jew, but the fraction of Jew obtained by cutting the Jew into as many parts as divisor. So perhaps it's not very clear because it's a bit tricky to get into these divisions, but what I would like you to feel is that there is a continuity between the concept of fraction understood as parts, units cut into a number of parts, and this algorithm of division, which goes through cutting units regularly to produce the quotient as to produce the quotient as set of measurement units. So what is really interesting is that in the oldest canon, which is the gnomon of the Jo, the one that was taught in the seventh position, but which is the oldest canon, we still have divisions of this kind, but with the introduction of a kind of decimalization. Since I've spoken a lot, I'm going to take you through this very quickly, just to give you a sense that the division is of the same kind as we have in the manuscript, and people think that these parts were written in 100 before the Common Era. Our oldest manuscript is 186 before the Common Era. So we have to divide something. It's a number, it's a distance in li to be divided by a number of day. It's to compute a daily change in the motion of the sun. It's not really important. What is really important is that first we get the number of li, then we need to find the number of pu, and the remainder in li is 889. What will be done is multiply by 3, and then the text says the quotient will be the hundreds of pu, multiply by 10, the remainder of the dividend, the quotient will be the tens of pu, so you see the decimalization, and you see the same kind of algorithm which changes the dividend without changing the divisor. And I've shown the text, and I've shown the same execution in the new division that is going to appear. You see that if I was carrying out this same procedure with the first division I've shown you, I would move leftward the divisor and compute digit by digit the quotient. First, in the first algorithm I've shown you, the dividend is never multiplied. The divisor moves, and the quotient is obtained digit by digit. In the earlier algorithm, the divisor never changes. It is like the matrix that is going to produce the units. By contrast, the dividend is going to be multiplied to be changed unit. And you have kind of measurement units attached to the result. Now, one thing is very important, that in the new way of computing, you have the result as integer, the quotient, digit by digit, plus numerator over denominator. This is a way of noting the key quantity. And now what I would like to show you is that this way of noting key quantities will recur in the context of multiplication and division because it is attached to the execution of multiplication and division. Whereas in the context of addition, fractions will not be written in this way. So just to remind you, yes? Yes, I will just take 5 minutes, even though I will not reach my handout, but it doesn't matter. You see the layout of division, empty row to begin with on top, middle row with the dividend, lower row with the divisor, and how it connects with the result quotient plus remainder over divisor. Now, if I applied a multiplication to this, I showed you that you have the same layout as the end of the division as at the beginning of a multiplication. I would multiply the lower by the upper to add to the middle. Okay, so this is the handout I gave you, and I began in the second example because the first example is okay. The first example is embedded in the second example. What is interesting is that you will find evidence of reference to positions in this text. Not all the positions are indicated, but some positions are indicated. So you have to multiply this number, 37, 2, and 3, and remember that this is restored, okay? I restore it on the basis of clues in the text, okay? So 37, 2, and 3 will be multiplied by this. This, the text says, goes below, meaning in the lower place where the multiplicator is. So you see, now, for the thing which is multiplied, we have two fractions, and the text makes explicit that we put the numerator to the left and the denominator to the right, and we carry out cross multiplication. We add the 20 to the 21, and then we divide the result of the sum of the numerator by the denominator, which is the multiplication of the two denominators, to obtain 1 plus 6 35ths. 1 is added to 49 to get, which is mentioned to be above, to get an operand in the form of upper, middle, lower. So you see how the positions of writing are embedded with the positions of the operands. That's the main lesson, if you want. Here, the position for the results of the operation are also the notation of the numbers that you are going to use to multiply. Now, the only thing I want to show you, and now the disaster that I had imagined has... Okay, just 1 second. Since I had foreseen this disaster, I prepared PDF, because I don't know why, if someone can explain to me, some texts from time to time, they become black, I don't know why. So, excuse me, I just want to show you one thing. So I've showed you two ways of writing down fractions in the context of operations. And what I want simply to show you is that exactly the same notation, so there is a standardization of the operands. There is a standardization of the operation, but not of the notation of fractions as such. Okay? So here you have a division. Here you have a division in the 13th century text, which is showed. So again, it's quotient in the top, dividend in the middle, divisor below. And the result will be quotient, numerator, denominator. So you have the same stability of the writing of the result as result. I skip this. You have another example where you have integer, numerator, denominator written as such because it's going to be the operand of multiplication. And now, exactly the same text, numerator, denominator. When I translate here, I'm translating the mentions that you have here. Numerator, denominator, numerator, denominator. The same layout for the addition of fraction. So what was standardized from the beginning of the Common Era to the 13th century in this tradition where the author refers to the canons, okay? What was standardized was the way of writing an operation to execute it, but not the notation of the objects themselves. Even though the objects had been produced within the context of another execution, taken out of this execution and reinserted into another operation. That was my main message. Thank you. And if someone can explain to me why the text become black in PowerPoints, I have no idea when that happens, why that happens. Ah, this one too became black. Okay.
I have a question. Whether there is an equivalent of incommensurability, or does the practice of changing
the units?
Can you
speak a bit?
Yes. I was wondering if there's a equivalence of incommensurability, or whether the practice and the change of units avoids it somehow, or if is it discussed or not? Or
so, in fact, what I think is that the writing of numbers with counting rods becomes a new technology. So I think that at the time of the manuscript, practitioners used counting rods, but not in the same way as starting from the first century. A key element for this is that never before the first century, you have a multiplication by 10 carried out by a shift. So multiplying by 10, 100, and so on becomes shifting something written with counting rods only after the first century. Before the first century, you never have any shift. You have multiplied by 10 as a number. So rods are used, but in a different way. Numbers, in fact, have a different nature. And because numbers have a different nature, they become the key element of the execution. So you have measurement values, transformed into numbers with which you compute and you return measurement values. But inside the execution, you operate our unmeasured numbers.
Question, so such a problem as incommensurability doesn't arise.
So I'm sorry, because I began answering in the direction of your question. So what I want to say is that, as you could see, you have an overlap between the two practices, because, for instance, you have a concept of fraction that occurs within type of execution that will circulate to the other concept of fraction and be produced with the numbers. So it's not that, it's simply that the technology of the operation changes, but you have overlap between the type of results you have overlap between the type of fractions you have. So you have overlap and differences, but I don't think you can speak of incommensurability. I'm sorry, because I began in going in that direction and I stopped on my way.
Okay, thank you. This was a very brilliant and very interesting talk. I wonder how this relate to later Indian and Arabic text, because we have very similar procedures, and I guess perhaps, but you have to tell us if the Arabic methods of doing these algorithms and the Indian way start with China, I don't know.
Okay, thank you very much for this question, because it's a very important question. So, you know that, first of all, for me, place value notation is used in China from the first century of the Common Era. But again, I have insisted on the fact that we have indirect clues, the indirect clues being shifting leftwards, shifting rightwards as multiplying by a power of 10 or dividing. So these are the clues. Now, Buddhism.
You do exactly the same.
Yeah. Let me finish. Okay. So Buddhism arrives in China in the first century, spreads in China starting from the first century of the Common Era. So what goes in what direction? I don't know, and probably we will never know for lack of evidence. But what is really important is naturally that we have similar, and insist similar, technologies to compute. But we have exactly the same challenge for Sanskrit text, and there I rely on what Agathe reacted earlier, and for Arabic text, and for this I rely on the work by Kunich and so on. Arabic digits never occurred in text before the 10th century. That's exactly the same story. They were written on other supports. So in fact, we have very similar practices. It's only later that we have the Arabic digits represented into Arabic sources, and most of the time as figures. So look at the figure, and there you have the Arabic digit. So I relied on papers by Paul Kunich, who observed the earliest evidence in written sources. But I think it's very problematic to look for written sources for the place value decimal notation, because, in my view, it was a material system before it was represented into writings. And that's my That's the reason why I asked the question yesterday, because it's not because you do not have place value notation in the text that people were not using place value notation in computation. It's simply perhaps that they did not represent the material computation into the text. So this is something that, in my view, ought to be in the corpus you spoke about yesterday when you insisted that there were no place value. Yeah, but if I understood correctly, for instance, the first description in Sanskrit sources in the north, if one might say so, the first description is in the Aryabhatiya, and this is much earlier than the inscriptions. So we have written evidence before we have actual written evidence of place value notation written in documents. So that's, I think that's one reason, because we know that people were computing on material supports. And so the question is to restore what was happening on ephemerals, where people were computing and where the place value decimal system was used. Because in my view, it's much earlier than what we have in text.
See. So that, and we know that the partnership rule is functioning in the same way in India. I'm not discussing the level of number of notations, but the computations.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then my main thing is analog to your saying that numbers change their nature. If we look at how algorithms solve the simple question, 15 is equal to 18 minus 3 things. Then you complete, and that means that you fill out the 3 things so you get 18, and then you have to add on the other side. That is, he presents the reduction of the equation in a way which corresponds to Euclid's common notion. If you add same things to the same things, we think about, we move 3x to the other side, then we have to change the sign. So we have also got a different conceptualization of it, and it's very difficult for people to see what really is written in algorithmic text.
But, yeah, so algorithmy, we have two problems, at least. One is the algebra, the interpretation of the algebra, and so on.
Yeah, but it's just that things can change.
And we have, Sure, sure, sure.
But the way people see the nature may change.
Yeah, one question, but why do they start drawing content blocks if they could describe things without drawing them?
You know, the question why is a bit difficult.
I understand, of course.
But, there is something which is extremely important. You see, here, for instance, two-thirds is written with characters. And it's only in the diagrams that this is going to be written as two numerator and three denominator. So these things are not interchangeable, contrary to what for us, we could write two TWO and then thirds TH, blah, blah, blah. and we could write two-thirds in the text. But here, where you use characters and where you use this are not the same. You will not find two-thirds written with rods in the text. Okay? So it's an addition to the text. And this addition to the text, we find starting from the 10th century, but not everywhere. For instance, the first text in which we find is a multiplication table. For instance, 2 times 2, 4. 4 is written with character, followed by counting rods. But 2 times 2 is not written with counting rods. Okay? So, first of all, we need to study the function of these insertions before we can answer your question. But this text from the 13th century is basically the main one. It's not the only one, but it's the main one where we have lots of diagrams representing computation. And here it's very clear that these diagrams are representing computation. Now, to give another answer to your question and to return to Erwin's question, we know that in the 9th century, paper began being used in the Arabic world. I have no idea about prices of paper, about how widespread paper was. I have no idea about the price of paper and so on, starting from this period. But it's true that when you have paper, and when paper is more easily available, as it is, for instance, in the Arabic world in since the 9th century onward, texts change. So that might be a reflection, I don't know. That might be a reflection of this simple fact. But for me, it's part of a phenomenon that has not been studied, which is the migration of mathematical activity onto paper. And I think this is a major transformation. We live with paper, but not everybody was living with paper. And the consequences of this perhaps can be approached from this point of view. I don't know. It's a question.